Are you still glad that you're a citizen of the United States of America, in spite of all the craziness? We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they're endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You say, well, Pastor, America has not always lived up to those principles, but we're striving to. How many know that the church is founded on the principles of Christ's word, and we don't live up to those principles like we ought to? Amen? But how many want to? During the Civil War, a song was written that I'm sure you know. But over the years, they've changed one of the lines. As those soldiers put their lives on the line for the liberty of others, they sang, "As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free." That's the spirit of sacrifice, isn't it? Jesus said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." And so, I don't know about you, but I'm glad we're not under Sharia law. I'm not glad we're not under the Nazis' Third Reich. How many is glad for all those that gave their lives so we could have the liberties that we have? Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Sing it, church. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. He is sounding. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer, and be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Praise him.
Savior, if you've got If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. Oh, mention of your name.
So you might not like the title of this message this morning, but it's not just for you. When I think of the sacrifices of those who have gone on before us for the liberties that we have, men like Abraham Lincoln and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., but most of all the Lord Jesus, everything he did was he laid down his life. The liberties that we have in the spirit are due to the blood of Jesus, and the liberties we have in the natural are due to the blood of those who were selfless enough to say, my country means more to me, my children mean more to me, my grandchildren mean more to me than my own life does. Amen. And so the older I get, the less I'm concerned with what I have. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I'm concerned about the future of this nation. First of all, I'm excited that I believe we'll see the rapture of the church, but I want to preserve what we have that is good for the next generation. It's not just about me. And most of the theology that I hear on so-called Christian television, it's all about your best life now, if I can say that, and how you can have it wonderful and how you can be blessed. But God told Abraham something. I want you to get this. He said, in you, he said, I will bless you. And in blessing you, in you will all the nations of the earth be blessed. Aren't you glad Abraham didn't decide it was just for him and his son Isaac and that was it and it was over? Because how many appreciate that we worship today the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? And God told Abraham, I bless you so you can be a blessing. The Apostle Peter says it this way in 1 Peter 4, verses 7 through 10, but the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. Listen, above all things, have fervent love for one another, for love will cover a multitude of sins. How many know if you cover your own sins, you won't prosper? But if you love your brother and sister, you don't get on the phone and gossip and share all their sins. You want to see them redeemed, right? So that's what he's saying. Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. As each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God, good stewards of the multifaceted grace of God. I knew of an attorney who was given charge of an inheritance when a gentleman passed away. And it was his job to get a hold of the living relatives that were mentioned in the will and distribute the funds to them. He would, of course, get his commission and get a large chunk, but he did not do as he was commissioned to do. He thought, well, most of them don't know, so I'll just keep it a secret and I will keep what's supposed to be for others for myself. And he wound up in trouble with the law. Did you notice that the Bible says we're stewards of the manifold grace of God? How many of you, if you have a 401k, would you want your agent to keep that for himself since you've worked hard all your life to put into it? It's getting quiet in here. You see, if you're a steward of something, God entrusts you with it. Now, he wants you to enjoy the blessings of it, right? He wants you to be blessed in your own life because of the gifts he's given you, but he didn't give them to you just for you. And sometimes the reason we don't receive more from God is because we don't think of anybody but ourselves, and he's not going to pour it in if you don't learn to pour it out. So we need to seek the things of God for the benefit of others. How many believe in the fruit of the Spirit? The love, joy, peace, gentleness, meekness. I want to ask you something. Have you ever seen an apple tree eat an apple? Have you ever seen a grapevine eat a grape or drink a glass of juice? Is their existence for the benefit of themselves or for others? Even the gifts of the Holy Spirit that God places in your life. God gives you the gift of healing. It's not so you can just be bragging about the gifts that you have and telling everybody about how wonderful and talented you are. No, it's for the benefit of somebody that needs a healing. And we need to understand that we have turned this thing into such a selfish thing that we forget that we are to be conduits. A couple of years ago, I had the privilege of visiting Israel. And I wanted to go, and it was so cold. But I'd heard you can't sink in the Dead Sea, so I got in it anyway. I mean, like to froze to death. But it's a weird feeling. Anybody else been in that? It's full of minerals. Nothing lives in it because, you know what? Everything flows in. Nothing flows out. The only way water leaves the Dead Sea is for it to go up with the sun bringing it up into the atmosphere. And I'm afraid some of us wonder why God won't give us the life. You feel dead inside. I'll tell you what, he's not going to keep pouring into you if you don't find ways to pour out into the lives of others. Amen. When I first started pastoring, I met a gentleman from India, Dr. P.J. Titus. I don't know how many of you are familiar with his ministry, but just reached literally thousands, one of the largest full gospel ministries in Kerala in South India. And he said to me, a little restaurant here in Buchanan, he said, I don't understand the mentality of the American church. He said, when we see people saved and filled with the Spirit in our meetings, we train them and tell them to go to the next village and see who they can reach. We send them out. We send them out. He said, in America, all the churches try to keep everybody in and get mad if anybody goes out to start another work. And he said, and we wonder why we don't have the effect that we need to have on the nation. And I'm so glad he told me that while he was young. And I can say, and the council can witness this, anytime somebody feels called to the Lord to start another ministry, out of way of holiness, if it's legit, if it's Bible-believing, if it's Bible-based, we will support them in their endeavors, not say, well, you got to stay in this church. And I believe the reason why God pours resources in is because we pour resources out. Right. in our missions programs and in our local missions. We give 20% of what comes into this ministry or more to missions, because I don't believe it's right to receive tithes from you if this church just holds it for itself. One time, we needed over $40,000 to resurface the parking lot. Now, that's not pocket change to me. Might be to some of you, but we met with the council. We didn't have the money to do it. You know what we did? We prayed and we looked at missions programs and we gave more to missions. You know what happened? Within a week, a check for that exact amount was dropped into the offering plate at this church. Am I telling the truth, folks? It happens time and time again. Every time there was a need. I remember we needed $10,000 to remodel the building over there and put a stage in for the youth and a basketball court. We didn't tell anybody. We prayed, and the lady that's here this morning showed up. She didn't know, and she said, God told me to give $10,000 to the youth program. Amen. See, we're pouring out into the lives of the youth. We're pouring out into the community, pouring out into the ministry, so God pours in. I guarantee you, if we get stingy with others, God will get tight with us. I'm going to prove that from the scripture before it's over. Paul said something that's really amazing. He said, if I could, I would be accursed myself that my brethren might be saved and receive the gospel. Now, Paul wasn't saying I'd like to go to hell. Paul was saying, I would if I thought my losing this would cause them all to come to Christ. What was he saying? It's more important to me that others receive this gospel through me than just me. I listen to what the psalmist says. This is ancient Israel, but how many's read through the Old Testament and found out that they'd get all worldly, they'd go into idol worship, they'd sacrifice their children on the altars to idols, they'd leave God, there'd be correction, God would withhold his hand of protection, the Babylonians or their enemies would come in and conquer them, they'd pray and repent and get right with God, and God would get them out of the mess and prosper them and bless them, and then the next king would start the same cycle over and over. Anybody see a parallel here? So I want you to listen to what the psalm says about their attitude. Psalm 106, verses 10 through 13, talking about when God brought Israel out of Egypt. He saved them from the hand of him who hated him, Pharaoh and the devil. He redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. The waters covered their enemies. There was not one of them left. Then they believed his words. Then they sang his praise. But they soon forgot his works and did not wait for his counsel. Oh, God, save me. Oh, God, help me. Folks, I've pastored for over 30-some years. I've seen it over and over. People mess their lives up, do everything opposite of what Jesus said. And then when everything goes to hell, they come to church, they bawl and squall at the altar. And if God don't fix everything they've messed up in 2 weeks, they're gone. It don't work that way. As a young man, Sonia was baby. Tamara and Sarah were small. She's probably a toddler. I got sick of church and church people. Anybody ever been there like me? And I decided I was done with it. One of my little girls happened to come into the room while I was sitting there moping and feeling sorry for myself and being self-focused and thinking I was just done because all the hypocrites in the church, not realizing anytime you think the church is all full of hypocrites, it's probably because you're being a big one yourself. Right. How many of the world's full of hypocrites too, especially the political world? I'll stay out of that today. I want you to hear this. One of my little girls happened to walk into the room and ask me a question about Jesus. And I said, God, I can't turn away from you. Because it's not about me. I don't want to be responsible for not guiding and directing the next generation to you. Don't care what the bishop does. Don't care what the preacher does. Don't care what the deacon does. I don't care if the church is deacon possessed. I'm going to serve God. Amen. Amen. Because it came to a stark realization that I wouldn't want to hear my children scream out in eternity, "Dad, why didn't you teach us? Why didn't?" And folks, you don't teach just by what you say. You teach by who you are and what you do. Amen. And I didn't want to be responsible. I didn't want their blood on my hands. And I turned my heart back to Christ, and I began to repent and call out to God. You said, "Pastor, well, you're wrong." I was definitely wrong, but I want you to hear what I'm saying. I cared more about what would happen to my kids, what would happen to those that God called me to touch, than I did about myself, because it had just been for me. I was done. I don't know why I feel to share that this morning. It's not my notes. Most of what I share isn't in my notes, but. Anybody want to be an example for that grandbaby? Come on. Anybody want to live right and talk about Jesus because of friends that you know that you don't want to see them messed up? If God sets you free from something, this church exists because my dad come home from World War II with PTSD and become an alcoholic, and his life was a mess, and God changed his life, and he wasn't happy just being changed himself. He wanted to see other people set free from the same thing he was set free with, or whatever they needed set free from. So if God sets you free from something, he wants you to be able to set others free. Amen. Now, I'm going to show you something in the New Testament that you may not have noticed. Did you know that the Holy Spirit at Pentecost came down from heaven like as of a mighty rushing wind, and there was a mighty wind, and cloven tongues of fire sat on each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost? Did you know from that time forward, people were only filled with the Holy Ghost as he flowed through other vessels that received it that day? Check it out. Peter preaches, others come into the kingdom. Peter and John go up to Samaria and lay hands on folks that they'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? Because you see, God didn't fill you with the Holy Spirit just so you could say, "Boy, I'm spirit filled and I can talk in tongues." The devil can do that. He can't love or live right though. He fills you with his spirit so his spirit can flow out of you into the lives of others. He's not coming back down here, getting back on the cross. Jesus is not to do the work over because his work is finished. He has now empowered you. He has filled you with his Holy Spirit. So when you share the gospel with others, you might not realize this, but God is flowing through you into the lives of others. So quit making it just about you. Hezekiah was a pretty righteous king, but at the end of his life, he says something that really disappoints me. What are you talking about, Pastor? God says, "Well, I'm going to withhold the judgment till the next generation." And he's like, "Whew, at least I'll be gone." I don't feel that way. I got grandbabies raging from 22 to down to 3, and probably more. Who knows what Alicia will do when she gets married. Don't tell her I talked about her today. But I care about what happens to my grandchildren and my children. It's not just about me. But not only that, I care about this community. I care about what happens at City Hall. I care about how it affects in whatever community you're from. You need to care about what happens in your community. You need to care about your neighbors. You need to care about those around you. You need to quit judging them and saying, "Why are they so rotten? Why are they so left wing? Why are they so crazy?" And start reaching out to them and see if God can't reach them through you. Back in 1920, so in that area, I read a story about a man who lived way up in the mountains and never seen a motor vehicle, just horses and mules. And how many of they were unusual then? Jim's old enough to remember. No, I'm just kidding. And so a little Model T or something came chugging up the road, and it scared the fire out of him, and he screams and yells and runs inside, and the driver shuts the car off and says, "Come on over here. It won't hurt you. It's good." Takes him for a ride. He has to get out front and crank it back up.
And as he comes on down the road, they go into the next little town, and another fellow that's never seen a car before says, "Oh my gosh," and starts acting crazy, and he says, "Run over that fool." You get the point? A lot of people don't understand what we believe. They don't understand the grace of God. They don't understand the reason you need a Savior. It's because there is judgment coming on a sin-cursed world, right? Some people preach grace and mercy, but they don't preach what it's from. Hey, listen, Jesus gave his life and took the price and the penalty for your sins and my sins. What I deserved was death and eternity without God in hell. But Jesus made a way that I could have life and that more abundantly. And he's abundantly shed his grace in my life. How dare I look at other people that haven't received him yet and say, "That fool's going to hell." Boy, I got quiet when I said that. So, but Pastor, some of them are given over to a reprobate mind. That's true, but you don't know who they are. If you'd have seen Apostle Paul before Jesus knocked him down on the road to Damascus, you'd have said, "What a worthless, hopeless specimen of a man. He's so full of hate and murder and envy, and he hates Christianity and everything about it." But God saw deep into his heart, and aren't you glad that it wasn't up? Did you know that the Apostle Peter and the other disciples didn't trust him at first? You know, it took a while. Barnabas had to kind of be a mediator between them to bring him and the church together because people, "Oh, God can't save someone like that." Well, he can if you're so hateful with them. Jesus said in Matthew 10:8, "Freely you have received, freely give." Has God been free with you with his grace and his mercy, his salvation, a song, a word, an encouragement? Did you know, in our era, and probably still up until a decade or so ago, most talented, successful stars on the stage when it comes to music started in church? Gift of God, singing for the Lord. I'll tell you what, don't ever count it lightly if God's given you a gift. He gave you that gift to bless others, to touch others, to reach others, to minister to others. It's not just for you. It's not just for you. So I need to stay in relationship with the Lord. I heard somebody ask Dr. Charles Stanley one time, said, how do you know what to preach on when you get up on a Sunday morning? He said, "I just figure whatever it is God's dealing with me about, you need it too." Huh? Say, "Pastor, you preach on mercy and grace a lot." Well, yeah, that's because I need to be forgiving. Amen. Tell the person next to you, "You need to be more forgiving, especially to me." Not to me, but to whoever you're talking to. Amen. So watch. If I'm not in a relationship to receive, I'll have nothing to give. So, "Pastor, I just pray and read the Word so I can be closer to God." That's not a good enough reason. I want to pray and get close to God and get into His Word so I can give what He's given to me to somebody else. Amen? Does that make sense? You remember what Peter and John said to the lame man in Acts 3:6? It says, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I unto thee." See, they're in relationship with God through the Holy Ghost. They're walking in the Spirit. They're hearing the voice of the Lord. God is speaking to them, and not when he speaks to them, then he speaks through them. And because they're in a relationship with God, when somebody has a need, God gives them what they need to meet that need. Last Wednesday night, we talked about the miracle of the loaves and the fishes. So here's a kid with a lunch from Long John Silver's, and he shares it with the disciples. Actually, it wasn't Long John Silver's, because then it would have been hush puppies instead of bread. But it's not much. But listen, he takes what he has, he gives it to the disciples, who puts it in the hands of Christ. Christ blesses it and there's no visible change. Am I right? But he gives it to the disciples, and the more they break the bread and the more they distribute the fish, the more it grows, because he said, they don't need to depart. You have something to give them. So the enemy will tell you, you can never minister to others. You can never do what God wants you to do. Can I tell you, if you take what you have, put it in Christ's hand, let him bless it, that he will multiply it to others? I can't count the times that I've had to counsel with people or meet with people or share a word with people and even go preach somewhere, and I'm nervous about it. You ever get nervous about it, Pastor Jim? When sometimes I still do. But I tell you what, I've learned the Holy Spirit never fails. When I don't have a word, he does. And if I'll depend on him and I'll let him give me words, then the words that I speak will be words from him, and they will be spirit and they will be life. No, you don't want to hear what I have to say anyway if his anointing isn't on it, if he's not speaking. If you don't believe that, ask my wife. She says, don't pay any attention to him unless he's in the pulpit and anointed. Lord. So, if you give of what God gives to you, we used to sing a little chorus in the church when they took the offering in Ohio. You marched down and dropped it in the front because it said, bring your gifts to the altar. And if you give unto the Lord, he will give you more to give. Amen. So you said, well, how do I give to him? I'm not talking about just the offering tonight, folks. I'm talking about you pour out into the lives of somebody. You find somebody to mentor. Find somebody to speak grace to. Find somebody that you can benefit. You know, I've had God meet financial needs for me when I've given stuff to people that didn't even make sense. I'll give you one illustration. We were in the old sanctuary. I was standing shaking hands with people. I think it was $50. The Holy Spirit said, give $50 to that person. And I'm like, okay, I'll have to write a check and date it for Tuesday because I don't have it. But how many know, you know, when he impresses you to minister to somebody in giving? The person had a need. The person that shook hands with me in front of that person put a $50 bill in my hand and said, the Holy Spirit said you'd know who this was for. If you're willing to give, he will bless you and give you the ability to give. Now, let me show it to you in the Word. I'm very careful not to make real statements in a word, in a message to you that I can't back up with Scripture. 2 Corinthians 9, verses 10 through 12. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seed that you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. While you are enriched in everything for all liberality, that means generosity, which causes thanksgiving through us to God for the administration of this service, not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also is abounding through many thanksgivings to God. Now let's look back at the beginning of the text. It does not say he supplies seed to the hoarder. Does it? So Father, plant your word into my heart. This isn't just talking about finances. May it find fertile ground, and may I be able to share what you have done in my life with others. Because I want the Holy Spirit to flow through me. I want God to speak through me. I want him to touch through me. I want my life to be a benefit to somebody. I've been a hindrance. Now, I know you never have. How many's ever had a bad attitude and not been right with God? Don't raise your hand. And you know you probably stood in the way. You were probably one of the ones, and I was probably one of the ones, they said, well, if that's a Christian acting like that at Walmart, I don't want to be one. Huh? I don't want to be scoring points for the other team. Do you? I was so bad at softball that the other team said, you're the best player that we have. Did you get that? They knew if I was out in the field, I'd drop the ball. If I was to throw it, I wouldn't get it to where it needed to go. And they're like, oh boy, I'm glad he's there, because I don't want to be that way in the kingdom of God. Amen. I want whatever he's given me, I want to be able to put it into the lives of others. You say, Pastor, you don't know the hell I've been through. He does. And I can guarantee you there's not one experience you can walk through in this life that God can't teach you compassion and grace and stability and strength and victory through that experience. And then you can pour that wisdom into the life of somebody else that's trapped where you were. I don't know why he lets us go through such things. I don't have all the answers. But I do know what Job said. I know. I look behind me. He's not there. I look to the left, to the right. He's not there. But I know he lives. And I know when I'm tried, I'm coming forth as pure gold. We have a brother here this morning, and we don't understand what happened in the last year for his incarceration, but we know that hundreds of lives have been touched by his testimony and his witness in that difficult place where he was. And not only that, God brought him through a physical situation that could have killed him. Jim, we're honored and blessed and proud to have you with us today. So glad you're here. I don't understand a lot of things, but I do know this. Whatever grace he pours into my life, I want to pour into the lives of others. God be merciful to you. God bless you. God give you grace. God give you strength. Stand with me. We're going to pray. When we were installing the sound system in this building, we wanted the best. We used acoustical spray on the ceilings. We put acoustical panels up the walls. We wanted it to be right. How many believe what God, to present the gospel, it needs to be quality? Other than when I'm on the piano, it usually is. But you can tell when I make a mistake, Tammy will go. In case you didn't hear it. But it costs a lot of money. Some of you may remember this ministry. We had Jimmy Swigert's old sound technician come in and design our sound system. And I was downtown, and I was pretty proud of what we were doing for this sanctuary. And a man said to me, I think it's a shame when there are poor people in this county that you all would spend that kind of money on a sound system. I said, it's because we pour into this county thousands of dollars and help the poor people in this county that we're able to have a good sound system. Amen. Isn't it funny? Nobody cares if they have a quality stadium for football. Nobody cares if there's quality for everybody else, but you want quality in the house of God, and somebody else saying, oh, that's a waste. You ought to read about Solomon's temple. Amen. So what we're saying today is God will meet your needs over and abundant what you need if he can trust you to pour into the lives of others. Right. Amen. 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 So we're going to pray for God's grace so that we can be more gracious. Amen. Amen. We're going to pray for God's mercy so we can show others what his mercy is like. We're going to pray for God's blessings on us. That one line in that old hymn, I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior. I think, well, that sounds selfish. It isn't selfish. You can't bless somebody else if you're broke. I know. I normally don't talk about things like this. Am I telling you the truth? So I don't understand some of the economic minds so-called in this nation to destroy all the businesses and everything that makes a profit. Because if you're broke, you can't hire anybody. I want God to bless you so you can be a blessing. But more than any of those things, I want God's very Holy Spirit to flow into your life so he can flow through you into the lives of others. Do you know the disciples could lay their hands on folks and they would be healed and filled with the Holy Spirit? I don't know about you, but I want to be able to touch, and when I touch somebody, that the life of God will not just be in me, but will flow through me to minister to that need. Let's all pray about these things. Father, we want your grace. We want your mercy. We want our talents that you've given us. We want to be able to sing, to play, to preach, or to be athletic. Even in the world of sports, I see so many testimonies from professional athletes that are Christians. God, whatever giftings you've given us, whether we're good bookkeepers and we work in that office, or we're in the hospital, staffing the hospital, may we minister everywhere we are, whatever gifts you've given us. Ask us, Father, how can this gift not just bless me, but bless somebody else? Jesus, every gift you had from your Father, you used it to minister grace and blessings to others. This is our prayer this morning. Fill me, bless me, reward me, gift me. Give me the gifts of your Spirit and gifts in other areas. Not so I can be somebody awesome, but so I can use that to benefit somebody else so they'll know how awesome you are. If you're in agreement with that prayer, say amen. 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 The altar's open. Jesus.
long as I shall.